Welcome to the Virtual Memories Show. I'm your host, Gil Roth, and we're here to preserve and promote culture in this benighted age, one weekly conversation at a time. You can subscribe to the Virtual Memories Show through iTunes or by plugging our RSS feed into your favorite podcatcher. You can find the RSS feed on our websites, vmspod.com or chimeraobscura.com/vm. We're also on Twitter and Instagram at VMSPod, at virtualmemoriespodcast.tumblr.com, and on Spotify, YouTube, and tunein.com by searching for Virtual Memories Show. And visit patreon.com/VMSPod or paypal.me/VMSPod to make a one-time or recurring contribution and help me continue to produce smart conversation about books, art, comics, and culture every week at the Virtual Memories Show. Before we get to the show, here's a reminder that I'll be interviewing the cartoonist Seth at the Strand Bookstore in New York City on May 7th at 7 p.m. in support of his new collection, Clyde Fans. You can visit the Strand's website, strandbooks.com, and look up the events calendar to find us. You'll need tickets if you plan to attend. And that's May 7th, 2019, for you time travelers in the audience. Now, I'm off to Chicago Monday for a conference, so this week's episode is up a little early. I'm planning to record a podcast while I'm there, and I hope to get dinner with past guests Audrey Niffenegger and Eddie Campbell while I'm there, and also try and get in a couple of hotel treadmill sessions to prep for next week's 5K race here in town. I ran that race's route last week one day during lunch, managed it just fine. My time was pretty good. You'll find out next week how I did. The other thing is I managed to get a little social non-podcast time this week, and it's rare for me to do things that aren't either work, running, or the podcast. But on Thursday, one of my old friends was celebrating his birthday, so we honored that by going on an 8-mile hike up Barefoot Ridge in Greenwood Lake. He's a big hiker and doesn't get to do enough of it nowadays, so that was a real occasion for us. It was fantastic. We had an amazing time. I posted a few pictures from it on Instagram, that VMS pod. But my calves have not forgiven me yet for going in my waterproof sneakers rather than hiking boots. So I'm hoping I don't have any permanent damage, especially with that race coming up. But anyway, my pal and I, we've known each other for more than 40 years, and I was glad that we could just have some time together to shoot the breeze, you know, just catch up on old times, compare our moderate midlife non-crises and whatever. On Saturday, past pod guest and pal, Dmitry Samarov, came to New York for a day trip from Chicago. We met up at the Frick Museum to see the new Moroni exhibition, which was a blast. Moroni, there's a great piece on this in the New York Times. He was one of the first realist painters. He gets overlooked throughout history. This collection at the Frick has a whole bunch of his paintings, but also has physical artifacts from that era. Like there's a painting of a tailor, and they actually have these 16th century tailor scissors or shears there. Some chainmail from similar to what this one cavalier is wearing in a painting. One of the most creepy and weird artifacts I've ever seen, which is a marten, sort of like a stoat, with a big gold mask on it. It's really weird. Anyway, if you're in New York or coming to New York, go to the Frick. You'll be able to see this again, spring of 2019. After the Frick, Dmitry and I walked from there, East 72nd Street, up to West 112th, through Central Park. We had to go to Book Culture Bookstore to drop off a few copies of his new book, Music to My Eyes. And we just hung out and talked. We just shot the breeze. We got lunch and coffee after that, and we talked art and writing and working with an audience and our moderate midlife non-crises. It was a good time, and not having microphones made it a more interesting conversation, because most of the times Dmitry and I have talked, it's been on mic. But let's get to the conversation with microphones. This week, my guest is Ersi Sotiropoulos. She is the author of What's Left of the Night, a new book from New Vessel Press. And like all of New Vessel's catalog, it's in translation, and the translation was done by Karen Emmerich. Now, What's Left of the Night is a novel about the great Alexandrian poet, C.P. Kavafi. And it takes place over 3 days that Kavafi and his brother spent in Paris in 1897 during a short holiday in Europe. Now, at the time, Kavafi was an undistinguished mid-30s, 30-something-year-old poet. And in the book, Ersi posits that this period, these 3 days, may have been a critical turning point in Kavafi's career. Because after this, once he gets back to Alexandria, he abandoned the kind of cliche formal poetry he once wrote and began to establish himself as the great Alexandrian poet, C.P. Kavafi. You do not need to be a Kavafi acolyte to dig this book. I only have a smattering of his work under my belt. But Ersi manages to use him and this period as like an emblem of artistic aspiration and anxiety and transformation and a lot of other things. Kavafi is a complex figure, and I didn't know too much about him before this, but queer in a world where that was illegal. Oscar Wilde is just getting out of prison around the time of 1897 where this takes place. He's desperate to escape his mother. He's racked by his family's decaying fortunes, dismayed by the way Greece was humiliated in the Turkish War. And he's being exposed to this cosmopolitan Paris that, well, is very different than Alexandria. Now, against that backdrop, you get Kavafi and his brother, and they meet up with a literary frenemy. And they try to finagle their way to a super high class brothel slash den of iniquity called the Ark. And the Ark is going to come up in our conversation a few times. That's why I want to give you that context, because that's sort of the hidden goal of the book. And it's more his brother's goal than his. But for Kavafi, it becomes this central thing in the novel. But the thing about it is, beyond just the direct artistic aspiration and Kavafi's struggles with his own poetry in the course of the book, you also get him, well, Ersi portrays him sublimating his lust for a few of the men that he encounters in this period and in flashbacks. And there's this incredible segment in a hotel lobby where Kavafi is just trying to inch his hand close enough to stroke the hair of this young Russian dancer, and he can't quite get it, and something happens with the upholstery on this sofa, and it is this amazing episode in the book, in the way she renders not just desire that this character has, but it's restraint and what he has to hold himself back from doing. And that's of a piece with this whole novel. It's what makes it so glorious. Not just the aspiration, but the need to restrain oneself. And sometimes over-restrain oneself when you need to learn how to let go. So, Kavafi fan or not, you will dig What's Left of the Night for what it says about art, desire, the ways we try to transcend our time and our circumstances. It's a really wonderful book. And I really want to thank Michael Wise of New Vessel Press for suggesting Ersi and I get together during her recent U.S. trip. I bumped into Michael at a reception a few weeks ago, and he was just so enthusiastic about getting us together to sit down, which we did at his apartment last week. He just said, you are going to get along with Ersi so great. You're going to love this novel. Send it to me the next day. And I fell in love with it and had a great time with Ersi. As far as caveats go, not a ton. Ersi has a deep, husky voice, as you're about to hear. She moved off the mic a little bit, so, you know, I amped up some of that. Also, we recorded at Michael's home, and he was in the room for it, much as he was when we had the episode we did with Sharif Majdalani, another one of his authors. And she hit him up once or twice to figure out a word in English, having French as their lingua franca, I guess. Anyway, since all of New Vessel's books are in translation, as I mentioned, I should note that English is not Ersi's first or second language, so my tone is a little slower than some of my high-speed neurotic asides that you guys might be used to. Here is Ersi's bio from the flap copy for What's Left of the Night. Ersi Sotiropoulos has written 15 books of fiction and poetry. Her work has been translated into many languages and has been twice awarded Greece's National Book Prize, as well as her country's Book Critics Award and the Athens Academy Prize. What's Left of the Night won the 2017 Prix Méditerranée Étranger in France. And now, the Virtual Memories Conversation with Ersi Sotiropoulos. What drew you to Kavafi for this book?
It's very long.
We got time.
In the sense that in 1984, I curated an exhibition at the Palazzo Venezia in Rome dedicated to Kavafi, and I came across this trip to Paris. I didn't know about that. And there were almost no information. Few memorabilia, like copies of the review L'Illustration, a shirt maker's card, but not a personal note, nothing. And I was intrigued. I mean, it was the first holiday and the last holiday trip of his life. Mm-hmm. What did he do in Paris? Whom did he meet? What happened to him? Thinking also of this abyssal distance between Alexandria, cosmopolitan but remote in a way, and provincial, and Paris, that at the time it was a very special moment, is that the is illuminated all over. Modernism was born there. Marcel Proust, Edgar Degas, Pissarro, Monet. Toulouse-Lautrec, artists from all over the world were going to Paris. So that was in 84, and I was just intrigued, and years passed. And in 93 or 91, there was a very good series in French TV that was a century of writers, was called. It was interesting because every time the director and the scriptwriter were different, so the view and the glance was completely was great, for instance, for Cocteau, for Joyce. And, I write the film for Kavafi. Mm-hmm. And I went again to Alexandria, and the same questions keep coming up. What did it happen? And years passed again. So I don't know how. Always this thing, the writing starts with a sort. It's not for me. It's never a plan that I want to write about this or about that. To tell it roughly is a sort of obsession, something that can be like very blurry, an image. I don't know, a fleeting conversation. Something comes and stays. You don't know why. Then you go digging. You don't know. Whatever happened, you don't know. So from 84 to 2015, when the book came out in Greece, how many years?
31?
It's hopeless. It's hopeless.
Was Kavafi a key figure for you as a writer?
No, this is the thing. Yeah. I mean, the poets that I grew up and were like models not only of writing but models of another world existing other than the world I knew in Greece. The poets of my adolescence were Ezra Pound, Eliot, and E. Cummings. Mm-hmm. So I like sort of like Kavafi, and I liked Seferis, but was not writing the book. And with all this documentation that I went through, he became to me very close as a person, to very nice, very. I mean, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed his not quality, defetti, the
flaws.
The flaws.
Yeah.
Because he was stingy, for instance. He amuses me very much.
Did you feel closer to him as a person than as an artist?
Yeah, both.
Okay,
both.
Oh, that's both. What. Yeah, that's a wonder. Okay. Was there a point where you realized you had to stop with the research? That you kept digging and digging and knowing that there wasn't documentation.
I was digging and the documentation was endless.
Yeah. But it never told you what you needed, right?
I still have, because, and thanks God, I forget everything. Because the brain cannot keep all that. So there were not only the Cavafy archives, of course. There were all sort of personal narratives, documents, letters, photos, books on the political and economic history of Egypt, books on the Greek Turkish War, novels of the 19th century, books on the architecture of Paris at the time, and of course many times I went to Paris and Alexandria, visited that time. And I was traveling because some of those could not have them online. I was going around, it was a sort of anecdote, a joke for my friends. I have a suitcase that was 58 kilograms, I don't know how much it is in pounds.
Yeah.
And I have a good friend who is a poet living in Los Angeles, Paul Vangelisti, and he almost kicked me by telephone, but he kicked me. I realized that it was an excuse for not start writing all this documentation going.
And was that the trigger when he gave you
told me something, and that was the trigger. He told me, why else you don't write a proemium in ancient times, that before a poem there is the proemium, when the story is a little bit explained, or you explain why you are obsessed with this thing, why you have to write for it. And then he told me, perhaps you are going to throw it away, but or perhaps will be part of the book. And this is the beginning of the book at the end. So I started writing. I followed his order.
Mm-hmm. Was this your first historical fiction?
Yeah, it's not. I don't think that it's historical.
The first one with
In another time, not
with
another,
with a living person that you're basing
a living person, yeah. And not very contemporary as all my other novels.
Yeah, that's what I mean, just something where you had an actual person that you were using. Despite all the research, did any Cavafy experts complain that you got something wrong as far as the actual time?
Someone, a French one, complained that perhaps, probably Cavafy could not know so well the poetry of Rimbaud. But I have also all the annals and the all whatever he had at home in his library.
Yeah.
And they were not a collection of Rimbaud, but a collection with an anthology with Rimbaud poems.
Okay, so nothing factually.
No.
Good.
But
you did
I worked
research.
A lot of it. Yeah. I worked a lot. Mm-hmm. But because it's fictional, but has to be based in something that it's not whatever. Yeah. Out of the blue.
Trust me, I did the same thing in college to a much lesser extent with the idea that George Orwell stopped in Paris on the way to the Spanish Civil War and met Henry Miller. And I just, what happened? There's one day they spent together. I have to find out what happened with these two men. I was obsessed with Orwell's essay about Henry Miller.
But they did actually meet?
Yeah. Orwell actually stopped in on Miller in Paris on his way to Spain. And that's just, the fact that no one else has written that book yet kills me. I want to see the novel of that, which I will someday have to sit down and write.
You have to do it.
I guess, yeah. But this is the problem that your book highlights for me. This is a book about the process of artistic transformation. Mm-hmm. And I'm a writer who never got past the cliche formality that you used to characterize Cavafy in that era. What was it like, I guess, trying to capture what that sort of transformation it was like, that sense of, as an artist yourself, capturing the moment when you get past it.
30 years old.
Yeah.
In a way, he was a failure. All his poems, except a few ones, some exceptions, like The Walls and two others, all the poems until that date, the day of the trip, they're mediocre, clumsy, poor poetry. he's doing. He's full of lyricism. He's an awful poet about a cat. They're full of like a sort of sentimentalism because he imitates. Mm-hmm. But he was stubborn. Eh? He was very stubborn.
And then he found... In that absence, and that's what I find fascinating about the book, that you take a missing few days and kind of infuse that with...
Those days were like lost for me, so yeah. I start imagining... because the image we have in Greece, and I think all over the world, about Kavafis is somebody that is already old, with a sort of distance... And in sort of the sagesse,
wisdom.
I was interested at what happened before becoming Kavafi. Mm. As a young man, what happened? 34 is old for, it also was a sort of failure, all the story, family history, the thing that not only public, had started less than a year ago to work.
Yeah, the way you portray the family's decline and that sort of...
He suffered till the end for this. Mm-hmm.
What sort of challenges did you have recreating Paris, the mentality, especially of a gay man?
I have no, because I spent days and nights at the bibliothèque of the city of Paris. So I have books, I have photos... There are photos. In Alexandria, I went many times. I was to be sure that, for instance, his shoes from going to his home to the office, they can be full of dust again. So I did the walks, all that. The thing is that what happens not only with this book, with all my books, can arrive a moment that you say, where the book is going, what is going, what is for, what is this? And there, after a point that wasn't, I liked it because it was going sort of cyclical, a little before going to the last night to go to the Ark, I had this like a rebellion of the book against itself. So, and I felt that the Ark needed more, what more than I felt that would be a nightmare, because more would be like other 3-4 years in my life. And then the Ark would be another book. So, and all that is in the book, in the following book, because the following book, The Emails, is also a diary of the writing of this one.
Michael, you're going to have to issue another book.
It was strange, because what I felt, and of course that would be completely the collapse of the book, what I felt it was like, let's say from here, as this start of the rebellion, the chapter, like the chapter, a chapter against the other chapters. Let's say...
It's the first chapter where the future, the future Kavafi intrudes, right?
It was towards a little before the Ark, when they go to the Ark. Like, if it were a painting, let's say, if you were a not figurative, an expressionist painting, and you felt suddenly a huge impulse to do it like Pollock. Mm-hmm. So it was not possible, it would destroy the book, and I have to resist to that. And moreover, I felt that after that point, it has to be only, not even syllables. What a syllable is made of what? Like some, like that. So, and I resisted. And I had the last years of writing, I had the system. When I was young, I was writing at night. But now, older, I write early in the morning and going morning, night again. I'm starting like 3:30 in the morning.
Jesus.
Yeah. So Kadhafi's visited me in my dream.
Yeah.
And stayed to me, and there is the scene is there, because after, he said, listen, Ersi, was there, right? And he said, listen, Ersi. It was very normal that he came. In my dream was very normal, the situation. Don't try to take out the skin of the eggs. The eggs have no skin. Yeah. I don't know how it's translated.
I think that's how it comes out.
Have no skin.
Yeah.
So and I said, he's right.
The eggs have no skin?
Yes, yes. They have no skin, no pollock, no sounds.
Have you experienced anything like that previously? Have your other books fought back in that way?
I have a book, Eva. It took many years also. It's one night. It's the night before Christmas Day in Athens. And I wrote all the book. It all started with a scene with a voleur. Somebody tried to take
a thief
in the bus in Berlin. Tried to took my purse. I was completely ambushed. Anyway, but suddenly I don't know how. At a stop at Kurfürstendamm. I realized that I have no purse. And I saw a figure and I followed him. And I started running. And he ran. And then he turned to me and told to me, and that was the important thing I was trying to understand. It's okay, like a sort of... it was my mistake.
Yeah.
Like, yes.
Yeah.
It's okay, it gave me the purse. So... And then it was a little nightmare for 3 days in Berlin. And I remember the same night I met Jeffrey Evgenidis. And I present myself not as a writer, but as a hand reader.
As a palm reader. Oh, palm reader.
Yeah. And I predict, I think. But because I was very excited.
Yeah.
I remember I entered Cadevin. I went to the toilets, nothing was missing from my purse. And it was like imagining myself with the thief, feeling his disappointment after what happened. And so also trying to understand how I realized afterwards that the purse was missing, not at the moment that he was touching me. The bus was empty. That was also. And also why this thing and the way he talked to me. So anyway, I was in Germany at the time and I wrote a paragraph about that. And I was working a lot on this paragraph and I have a Chinese friend living in Berlin, and so I was translating the Greek in English. She was translating that in Chinese. She was correcting that in Chinese, going that and back and forth. 1 month, but at the end I had the perfect paragraph.
Yeah.
And I started writing the book. That was the first paragraph. I finished the book. Also, to give a push to myself, I gave it to... Everybody loved it. Gave a chapter to a good review in Greece. The chapter was published. Something was like... I don't know what. I went to a psychoanalyst. Were better times financially in Greece at the time. Yeah. He liked it, everything, etc., nothing. So I started writing it over. And this paragraph is place lost inside the book.
Yeah.
So the book is not starting with a perfect paragraph.
Did you keep the paragraph?
But
it's embedded.
But all the book is rewritten, even if it is the same thing, the night of Christmas. And a woman that cannot find a taxi suddenly starts walking in Athens, and she met a thief and two prostitutes, and they passed the night together. But it's completely different.
I'm sort of amazed when I saw that you have 15 or 17 books to your name, because it sounds like these are all agonizing processes for you to write. Do any of them come easier?
I think it becomes sometimes getting older. It's not either to get more confident or...
Yeah, are there things...
You don't have a certain naivete, but perhaps, that you have. I don't know.
So as you get older, you overthink too much, or do things get easier?
You know, I write and rewrite, and this is my...
Yeah.
That goes all the time. Perhaps is... for me, it's very important how you say things, because the stories are the same. Love, death, sex, betrayal. Since Homer, mm-hmm. we repeat the same stories. So it's not what to say, it's how to say it.
You prefer the Iliad or the Odyssey?
I think the Iliad. It's more.
Yeah. Same reason I like Purgatory over the Inferno.
Also, yeah. Odysseus, I don't know how you pronounce him. After a point, it's a little boring for me. He's a little boring.
Good. I'm glad. I just wasn't sure. I'm always an Iliad guy. The Odyssey is much more popular, but I like to. I have a theory about Achilles also that I'll share off mic. It gets long and weird. But with this book, what you just said about, you know, the story is the same, sex, love, death,
betrayal. No, the story is repeated. I mean,
yeah. And I wonder, I had the question, and when I asked Edmund White, he had the same question for you. Being a straight woman writing the perspective of a gay man mm-hmm. in this, did you have trepidation? Was it something you were comfortable
First
doing?
First of all, I think it is something I have thought of many years ago,
yeah.
that I am a gay man.
You are? My wife is a gay man also. It's cool.
So I am a man, like a man who likes men.
Yeah.
So I have no problem with
Good.
That.
Okay. Because the greatest scene in this book, as far as I'm concerned, is the one in the lobby with the sofa with the upholstery. And to me, it doesn't matter that it's gay or straight. It's
exactly.
It's restrained desire and everything that we...
And for that, what he did, Cavafi, is that I was in Girona in Catalonia before coming here. They were talking about Cavafi translations, and one of, I can't remember the name of, who has translated the canon, the 151 poems of Cavafi. He didn't translate all together at the beginning, so he was asking his wife, taking the advice, do you think this can touch all women, also women, the poem? And he was going on. So what he did, Cavafi, he talks about boys or young men, but... the thing is that the way he writes, the way he transcends the story in his writing, but he transcends without avoiding being inside the desire, can touch and transmit emotion to readers that don't share the same desire. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm sure a great writer can touch your writing about bulimia, even if you're not bulimic and feeling...
Yes, but we all experience desire that we can't follow through on.
And also, it's my idea that the trigger for desire, you don't need much. I mean, you don't need.
We
have the Kardashians to.
Yeah, it can be
so
just a.
For that, I wanted to arrive at the minimal, at the little hair.
Yeah. Can you talk a little about having your work translated and how much you have to help or assist the translators? Or is it something where you just kind of hand it off?
I'm very happy when I don't know the language.
Good.
I'm very happy. I'm very happy.
You know, so English, you just had misgivings
about? My English
about.
Is not good, but I'm, and this is something, English and American friends of mine, writers, tell me, I'm an excellent editor.
Yeah.
In French, in Italian, in English. Mm-hmm. So this is a problem.
You'd rather not be involved? And
then I see it, you know, because afterwards, her talking with people who have a sense of the language, I see that I am right. I'm not, you know, sometimes there are big crises with translators, with Karen Emmerich also.
And did she have questions that you needed to?
I have questions, but sometimes I overdo. I accept that I overdo. And, you know, the problem, if the translator is young and inexperienced, perhaps he will accept whatever I say, then he's not going to be good.
You may as well do it yourself, yeah.
But sometimes, as happened in France, the translator is so much well-known and he's doing à sa manière, in his way. And then we there are big confrontations.
Mm-hmm. Is there anything untranslatable in terms of this book or your work in general?
There was something that I told my publisher, Michael, and he didn't accept it. For instance, there is at a certain point, Cavafis walking and thinking, he was saying how much of his days is taken by poetry, by
dalliance and pleasure. Those are the other things. I dog-eared that page.
So, and love, etc. Yeah. So I think Kavask will come out if he heard, listen, the word love of something that it was from him, he will jump out from his grave. So in Greek is erotes, loves, but it's in the sense of affairs. Yeah. The affairs. Mm-hmm. We'll never talk about love.
Yeah, I recall it was, I think dalliance.
And then
was
Greek word for the, I don't know how it's called, for kaloperes, the Greek word is something about, Karen at the beginning has put relaxation. I said, it's not possible. It's relaxation, something new age. From the Midwest, the new age thing. It's not relaxation. Yeah. This galoperas in Greece, it means going to restaurants, eating, meeting friends, spending money, going to hotels. Is this way of life.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah. Any differences between male and female translators? We're having that thing now with Emily Wilson doing Homer, and it's different than Lattimore, Fitzgerald, etc., because it's a woman translating Ertha.
No, I didn't think I noticed. For me, as it is not the same book translated in the same language, for me, is the resistance of the foreign language that is different in its time.
Is there a language you wish you knew?
Mm-hmm.
A language you wish you knew?
Portuguese.
Yeah?
Brazilian, I like it very much.
Okay, I wasn't sure if it was for Brazil or for Portugal. So.
Yeah. And I tried, but I was, twice I was in Brazil and I was writing, and I was, when the teacher was coming, I was exhausted.
Mm.
But I like the language. What you would like to talk?
Oh, I have little itty tiny pieces of a million languages, but I'm American, so all I speak is English. I studied Attic Greek, Hebrew, Russian, Japanese. Nothing has stuck with me. My brother teaches Attic Greek in a private school because he actually stuck with the education we had.
I actually, you know what you are? I don't know if you have, you know this term?
The term dilettante. Oh, I was going to go with dilettante. What was yours?
There's this term that Voltaire uses for Diderot, that he was pantophile. I didn't know this word, not even in Greek. It's a Greek word. Pantophile. He liked everything.
Yeah. I'm insatiably curious. I don't go too deep. I go wide on every topic I can find, which is how I do this every week with people I've never met. You've been all over the world. Cavafy never leaves Alexandria again after 97, right?
No, he went for the first time. He went twice or three times in Greece. He went to Paris, he had never been to Greece before.
Yeah.
Then he made, and then he kept, when he went to Greece, he kept a sort of journal that is very, very bare. It's, look, I went there, I ate that, the price is this, the price is that.
Yeah. And that sense.
And then
of,
he spent all the time in Alexandria.
Yeah.
Working at this third circle of irrigation.
In a sense, is that more difficult for you to adjust to, someone who never goes, who never leaves that city?
It's more interesting, I think.
Yeah.
Because someone can go everywhere and then spend himself everywhere and then what?
I live in the house I grew up in. I've been there almost my entire life, which is, Americans, it's really weird. I've traveled all over the world, but I live in my childhood home.
And your parents are there also?
No. They live separately elsewhere. I took over the house. But yeah, I live in my hometown. And it's always strange,
yes,
when you tell people.
But your hometown is New York.
No, I'm 25 miles away from here. So I live in the woods with deer and bear. And a bear went through our yard just yesterday on Easter. I put out some strawberries, just the cuttings of them, in the backyard. An hour later, a bear just walked through the yard and just ate.
Big bear.
Decent size, not a huge one. I'll show you a picture when we finish up with the big
it.
One. Yeah, this is 25 miles from here. But yeah, I've
so it's in the woods, a house. It's not a town. Because
yeah, it's a little isolated.
I have to live,
Yeah. I have New York. I come in to do things like this, but... Yeah. But that was what struck me afterwards when I was reading up on Cavafy and realized that after this, Alexandria is pretty much it.
Another thing that is interesting is, while he was very careful about his fame, posterity in a way, and also he has, after that, taking care the way when people were coming to visit him, if they were important, what to offer them, whiskey, if not, nothing. How to put the candles, he had all the way how to put the candles, what part of his face was the best.
Yeah.
Years later, he adopted a guy, and the guy was sort of a little slave doing work for, and the guy was married, etc. And once, the guy gave a speech about Cavafy. And he wrote, of course, Cavafy. The other was not able. So, I mean, he was interested. He was wanted. He was vain. He wanted to be famous. At the same time, when Eliot, he asked him to publish some poems of him in Criterion, he was correcting the translation. Never happened.
So... vanity and well, it seems you capture that sense of anxiety that he has, regardless of whether he makes the artistic jump or not. But let me ask you, with all this travel, all the places you've lived and stayed, where do you consider home?
I love Greece.
Yeah.
I love Greece when I'm not there.
Yeah.
I don't know. I like hotels. If I have money, I would live in hotels.
Yeah. Like old grand hotels or pretty much anywhere you...
If it is a good... I would prefer a good hotel.
Yeah. Even in Europe, it's tough to find. I as a business traveler, European hotels, the showers are this wide and
last year, I was invited for the Night of Literature in Paris. Then I said I would like to stay 2 more days, and I paid the hotel, and it was very expensive for 2 more days. And the hotel was the room. Actually, I took pictures because it was like a box for a doll box.
We had to turn sideways and walk through. In America, you know, business travel, hotels, good size, but yeah, I go to Europe and you're going to pay way too much. And, But yeah, it's what do you like about that sense of moving or just not having...
there are writers that they like to have their desk, to have personal, I don't know, photos, pictures.
Yeah.
I work always, for that I'm going to also to residence, in a neutral. Every time I enter, even when I'm invited someplace in an hotel room, I feel like life can start again.
That there's no
towels, everything, and no traces. And all the same, it's like no traces, and you know all the lives that have been through this.
Yeah, that's actually advice that I give to people about things you shouldn't touch in your hotel room. I'll share that with you later on. But
once I remember I was in Lille, invited for something, and then I do like that. It was, how you call it, a collant, a woman like this.
Stockings
that were like scrapped. And in awful way, they thought that somebody have beaten up here. And
you have to assume the worst thing has happened in every hotel room you've been in. It's still great to go.
You know, it's all this virgin situation that you enter, and there's so many people passed there, cried, maybe died there, who knows.
Whenever I stay in the Hotel DuPont in Washington, I always ask for the room where that Russian guy got killed. But they always just play a stone face at the counter. They pretend to have no idea what I'm talking about, but we know. When it comes to the book, though, there's one... we mentioned a section a little earlier where the future Kavafi, you know, is referred to when you talk about the Ark. And, you know, suddenly it's the Kavafi years later. Within the book itself, was it a challenge not to hint at the future, not to
to project the future?
Yeah.
No, of course, but it would be bad for the novel. The novel would be very bad.
Yeah, was it tough to get that balance?
No, I have to be there. I have to be at the moment.
Because I think of one of my favorite novels, The Leopard, or Il Gatto Pardo by Lampedusa, where just occasionally there'll be, you know, a World War II reference about a bomb destroying the palace that... These characters are all in 1860, and all of a sudden a 1942 moment occurs. But
no, I need to be stuck there at the very moment and see how it's happening, how this is going to happen. Because, for instance, this poem that is in the book in the first version, The City, it's a well-known poem. It took him more than 10 years.
Yeah.
It is one page, the poem.
So you felt some sympathy because of
that. Very much.
Was there, had you tried writing any pastiche of Kavafi? Had you tried getting into his voice to the point of trying to write in his style?
It was not possible. That was a choice because, first of all, Kavafi was talking a lot of English or French with his brother, so it was, and also the vernacularies of that time in Alexandria, of this decaying aristocracy of the Greek quartier, it would be. I made a choice for the language.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Anyway, Kavafi's poem, the language is a sort of mixture of the Motiki, the language of the people, Katharevusa, that was the high language of the newspaper. It's a sort, it's very particular, and this is something impossible to render in translation.
Hmm. How's the response been? It came out a few months ago in the U.S. I know it was received very well in Europe. Let's see. Have you been surprised by the readers in America?
I know, you know, in America, I think, and in England also, Kavafi is more known than in France.
Yeah?
Mm. In Spain also is very known. Mm. In Italy, so and so.
Why is that? Do you know?
You know, it's a story of translation, even if in Italy there have been many translations. But in France, there has been the first translation by Marguerite Yourcenar, who turned Kavafi from poetry into prose. They don't know him well. They don't. I know. I think in the Anglo-Saxon countries, they know him better.
And do you feel you can help popularize him, or at least raise his?
I think that people, mostly people who have already years ago read his poetry, will go back. Mm-hmm. I think so. And I mean, it's a response from friends or people I know that they read, and then I said, "Ah, let's look again at the translation." Go back to this man.
You tell me about your New York. You used to live here.
No.
Oh, you didn't? Okay, so once...
For some months. Or
okay, that's long enough for some people. But have you made occasional visits to New York, or are they pretty fine?
I have been...
Outside of this particular neighborhood, which I've always enjoyed because it's kind of quiet.
Very.
Yeah, it's good. You're close to the subway, but you're not in the middle of everything. What sort of New York do you like?
I am almost all the time. I stay at Soho in Sullivan Street. Mm-hmm. I have a friend, very good friend, that we met when I was 12, I think, or 11, at the French Institute in Patras.
Jeez.
Who lives here, married with an American artist. Mm-hmm. So and I stay there in Soho. That for me it was very nice how quiet it is here.
Yeah.
And then I spent 2 months, I remember, at an amazing hotel that was a few years ago, held by an amazing woman. That was an hotel, it will come, I can't remember now the name. 32nd East 33rd Street, that had all sorts of rooms. For instance, they have like banks where 6 people can go and stay, and then suites with Andy Warhol's real thing. It was the Gershwin Hotel. Mm. And then she sold it. I was the last. Ah. It was great to be there.
Yeah, there are things
the
that
once I met in the elevator, I knew her work, Orlan, you know the Orlan, the French artist. She was staying there, and she was very anxious to see my room. I told her that my room was very bare. She had a great suite, etc. and I had a show there in the hotel. I think it was the last, because after Suzanne, the owner, sold it, that was a hybrid thing with poetry, photos, and theater dialogues. Plato in New York. Mm-hmm. I think it was 2013, something.
Yeah, the city changes quickly on us. What's your writing practice like? I mean, you mentioned, are you computer, longhand?
I have not handwriting.
Yeah? Everything's got to...
I write with one finger. Mm-hmm. So I write with one finger. I don't use the other hand. Like I'm a sort of cripple, I have the other hand behind me. And if you have, I have started with a typewriter, and because even at, when I was very young at the moment, I have not, for instance, I have not an L, an A, etc. So when I keep notes, I cannot read my notes. So it's a sort of, I mean, it's something, it's a handicap, it's a sort of sickness, maybe.
But somehow the books keep happening, even though they're missing letters.
One finger.
Yeah. So. It could be
this
like
one.
A... Very good, yeah. We all can guess which finger she's showing. It could be like the Ulipo guys.
And even if I can write a bit quickly with this one finger, I have all the time, I have to look. I have not even memorized how is the...
The keyboard?
The keyboard.
Is it something you...
I'm not progressing in that at all.
Yeah.
I'm not progressing. I'm regressing, I think.
Are you happy with what you're doing?
I mean, in the sense that I write much slower than when I write by hand, you understand, with this system. But when I write by hand, many times, for instance, because I print every day what I have written, I print. And then as I wake up very early and work early, I mean, the creative time for me is until noon, 1 o'clock, after I am kaput. So afternoon, evening, I reread what, and I take notes by hand. And sometimes it's awful because I cannot read that it was something that I think that was good.
So there's going to be the lost notebooks.
But it's like you have, you were born with 1 ear or 1 leg, and you have to live with this. So it's very late to change.
One finger.
It's very late to change.
But you seem, again, pretty productive, all things considered. I have a question from Edmund White. When I told him you and I were getting together, he just asked, Kavafi lived in England, wrote in English. Why do you feel he's more culturally oriented to Paris? He didn't mean it in an accusing way, but he just...
He lived in London and in Liverpool, but he lived in... it has nothing to do with Paris. If the geographical situation was different, it could be London, if London was south. Because this is a trip. The days are more or less exact.
Yeah.
So this is a trip from Alexandria, Marseille, Paris, London. I take him... So they have been to Paris before going to London. That was the real tourist part of the trip. So I take him Viaggio di Ritorno before going back, because from a dramaturgic point of view, that would interest me.
Yeah.
So Paris is, because Paris is a stop before going to Marseille, etc. Yeah. This is Paris.
Okay. Yeah, I think Ed was applying, a grand cultural theme to it, I suppose. Do you agree with Madame Day that history is written to be erased? That's
For Greece, maybe she's right.
Yeah.
And, while I was writing the novel and with all this documentation, I discovered a thing I didn't know, for instance, that year, 97, after this La Défaite,
the Greek Turkish War. Yeah.
The country is bankrupted, and there is an international economic commission, and we're put under the control.
Yeah, where Greece was put under.
In 97.
Yeah.
This lasted for 80 years, till 78. And I remember when I was small, the matches, etc., Monopolium. Then I found out, reading about, that was money going to the forces. So, if you imagine that in 97 we are under economic control of the big forces, that goes on for 78 years, of 81 years, and I'm writing the book after...
Just in that moment as it's going to happen. Yeah.
And there are similarities.
Yeah, were you thinking of those?
Those things. I mean, I didn't know about that. And also, just before the crisis, we have this big event that I was against, and I hoped that they had to say no, the Olympic Games. That was the beginning of our bankruptcy.
It was in 2014. Yeah.
And that was the beginning of going down, down, down. Yeah. And many scandals started there with Siemens that they're not cleared yet. So, same thing, 97, that 96, the first Olympic Games in Athens. Mm-hmm. And I remember I escaped Athens at the beginning, but I remember how thrilled people were because, Olympic Games in both cases, also there, they were fully in depth afterwards, etc. It was a disaster also in 1896, the Olympic Games. But all this national sentiment was so much flattered for a very short time, obviously, but very much.
Yeah.
And Kavafi, for what I have read and how I could, he was disillusioned completely about this
national
patriotic flame.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Did you try and draw parallels more explicitly within the book about the current Greek situation, or did you feel it stood for itself?
No, it was...
yeah, people are going to get it.
Yeah.
So, the book is about, as you said, or as we said earlier, that transformation from being a hack artist into becoming something special. Do you remember any sort of experience like that for yourself? Did you have a moment where you learned that you could do something?
It's a moment that you...
Not that you were Kavafi, but the moment that you became Ersi.
You feel that you cut... I think I know I am Ersi since I was very little. But there is sometimes the moment that you feel that you catch the thing.
Yeah.
After trying or not trying and...
not even knowing that you were chasing it.
There is a moment that it comes, it feels almost independent for you, from you. That you feel, here I am, here it is. And, you know, in a book or even in a poem, after that moment, you cannot do whatever you want.
Yeah.
Because the thing is there, it has its own voice. You cannot go and do it and take it from there, do it another thing. It would be a disaster.
Yeah.
When you are there, in a certain way, not that it goes by itself, but then you have to follow also.
Mm-hmm.
For me, writing is a discovery. Otherwise, it would be boring.
Yeah. Do you prefer prose or poetry for writing?
No, I had published my book of poetry in 80.
Okay, I thought you had done poetry more recently. So we're going to say your prose.
Meanwhile, I have done a lot of visual poetry, and then I have a book published in Spain. And I republished a poem in Greece in 2018. Mm-hmm. So how many years after that you are going?
Not enough. Yeah.
38.
Yeah. But you prefer writing in prose, doing novels?
You know, or short? Poetry is very eclectic. She comes, because for me, it's a she, whenever she wants.
In keeping with the Greek, then, do you think more muse or daimon, the Socratic demon that leads? Which of the two myths do you kind of use for creativity?
I would say... I would say... a benevolent demon.
Okay. That's a good note to leave off on. Ersi, thanks so much for coming on the show.
Thank you. Thank you.
And that was Ersi Sotiropoulos. Her new book is What's Left of the Night, from New Vessel Press, translated by Karen Emmerich. Like I said, I enjoyed it a lot. I think you get the impression of that from the beginning of this show. And I am no Kavafi expert, like I said. You can enjoy this without knowing Kavafi's work inside and out. It's really about the insecurity and anxiety of art and the restraints we put on ourselves and our desires. And Ersi really, really nails that. As near as I can tell, Ersi has no social media presence or website, which, given the way she was talking about her typing skills, is probably for the best. I want to thank again Michael Wise at New Vessel Press for connecting us. New Vessel is doing great work. Check out newvesselpress.com. You'll find their Twitter and Instagram feeds there too. And you can find out more about their catalog and their mission to bring great world literature and translation to American readers. And after we wrapped, I asked Ersi, so, who you're reading? And if you want to hear her answer to that and get some extra conversation, you'll need to become a supporter of the Virtual Memories show so you can get access to our quarterly bonus podcast, Fear of a Square Planet. The first quarter 2019 episode features book recommendations and some extra conversation with Jerome Charon, Peter Cooper, Edmund White, Eva Hagberg-Fischer, Mort Gerberg, James Osland, Joe Chardello, James Sturm, Martin Haglund, Bram Presser, and Nathan Englander. You can support the Virtual Memory Show via patreon.com/vmspod or paypal.me/vmspod. And I've got all sorts of goals and goodies in place for patrons, including that podcast, a patron-only blog, handwritten show notes for every episode, my secret project that Dimitri kind of busted my balls about this weekend, and more. So go to patreon.com/VMSpod or paypal.me/VMSpod and support the art of fine conversation. And I recorded this one at Ersi's publisher's home in the Upper West Side. So that was about $12 for the toll at the George Washington. But I found street parking right outside my favorite garage, so I saved $35 there. And after we wrapped, I had not eaten in about 8 or 9 hours, and I spent $8 and a $2 tip on an absolutely phenomenal tongue burrito from the Super Tacos food truck on 96 and Broadway. So, if you want to help defray some of the costs of the virtual memories show, like web hosting, travel, equipment, tongue, or just toss me some money because you think the show is worth it, then visit patreon.com/VMSpod or paypal.me/VMSpod and make a one-time or recurring donation. A special thanks go out to Nick Bartosik, Michael Hacker, Michael Janizek, Fred Kish, Jonathan Kranz, Jack Les Camella, Teresa Lewis, Stephen Nadler, Jim Ottaviani, Payne Prophet, Dmitry Samarov, Stephen Solomon, Craig P. Steffen, Greg Tanner, Ford Thomas, new contributor Armando Veve, and Garrett Zecker for going over and above in their support of the Virtual Memories show. We have the full list of show supporters at chimeraobscura.com/VM. Now, our music for this episode is Fella by Hal Mayforth, used with permission from the artist. Check out my episode with Hal from the summer of 2018 and find links to his artwork and listen to his music at soundcloud.com/Mayforth. And that's M-A-Y, the number 4, T-H. And that's it for this week's episode of the Virtual Memories Show. Thanks so much for listening. We'll be back next week with, I hope, the artist and witch, Caitlin Foisey. We haven't recorded yet, so you never know. You can subscribe to the Virtual Memories Show and download past episodes at the iTunes Store. You can also find all our episodes and get in our email list at either of our websites, vmspod.com or chimeraobscura.com/VM. You can also follow the Virtual Memories Show on Twitter and Instagram at VMSpod, at virtualmemoriespodcast.tumblr.com, and on YouTube, Spotify, and TuneIn.com by searching for Virtual Memories Show. And if you like this podcast, please tell your friends, tell people on social media, and go to iTunes, look up the Virtual Memories Show, and leave a rating and maybe a review for us. It all goes to helping us build a bigger audience. You've been listening to the Virtual Memories Show. I'm your host, Gil Roth. Keep reading, keep making art, and keep the conversation going.